This video is a detailed step-by-step guide on how to install a standalone ECU. It's aimed at people with no previous experience doing a job like this, and it has the goal of demystifying the process. It covers everything, including the design of the wiring diagram, tools and supplies, sensors, the wiring process itself, as well as the install and physical location of the ECU and associated components. So, let's get started. Now, before we start any work on wiring anything, what we need to do is create a wiring diagram. A wiring diagram is by far the most important part of the job, and it will be something that you'll be constantly referencing throughout the install. The first step towards creating a wiring diagram is to look at the user manual of your ECU and reference the pinout. A pinout tells you which pin on the ECU is designated for what. I'm using an AEM Infinity Series 5 ECU, and here in its hardware specification sheet, you can find a detailed pinout. For example, here we can see that pin C16, which is simply pin number 6, that's the trim current signal for your Bosch wideband sensor, and you're even told which pin of your sensor should be connected here. If we scroll down a bit more, we can see which ignition coil should be connected to which pin. Below that, we have the crankshaft and camshaft position sensors in case you're using variable reluctance. And a bit below, we have the pins for Hall effect sensors, and so on and so forth. Now, upon first glance, a pinout like this may seem very intimidating as it contains a lot of unfamiliar words such as low side switches, falling edge fire signals, 10K pull-up, etc. But don't worry, in this video we'll build a detailed wiring diagram, and a high-resolution image of that diagram is available for download in the description. Using that diagram, you'll be able to see what can be safely connected where, and then you can reverse engineer this diagram, edit it, change pin numbers, and adapt it to pretty much any ECU or setup, regardless of whether you're running AEM or not. Because ultimately, the basic logic of any ECU or engine control unit is simply to read signals from sensors and control outputs to injectors, ignition coils, and other components based on those signals. So with the pinout, we have the basic idea of what can be connected where. The next thing we need to know is which pin is which on the connector itself. In other words, the logic of pin numbering on the ECU connector. That too is of course available in the instructions, and here we can see that we start counting from the bottom right of the connector and continue by reverting to the right side for every subsequent row of pins. So for example, if you're supposed to connect something to, let's say, pin 26, you will start counting from 21 here. So this is 22, 23, 24, 25, and here's 26. If you need to connect something to pin 34, for example, then of course it's easier to count back from 40. 39, 38, 37, 36, 35, and here's 34. This may seem basic and self-explanatory, but it's important to stay focused when you're counting, because connecting something to the wrong pin can cost you hours or even days of troubleshooting. Now, this ECU side of the pins that you can see in the instructions, it is useful, but you won't actually be working with this. You're not installing wires directly into the ECU. Instead, you'll be installing them into the connector that gets connected here. So for drawing the wiring diagram, I prefer to open the AEM Infinity Tuner software. You can download this for free from their website. And then I open my 506 layout. After that, I can open any of the pre-installed saved sessions, and then go to Wizards, Setup Wizards, and Outputs, and then I click on the pinout. What you want is this image right here. I will take a screenshot of this and paste it into an image editing software of my choice. I prefer to use this rather than this, because when doing the wiring, this is what you'll actually be working with and touching all the time. This is the back of the ECU connector, and this is where you'll be installing the wires. So it's a good idea to get familiar with its layout and orientation in connection with the numbering system. The pin numbering stays the same as on the ECU connector, but you will reduce chances of errors if you're used to how the numbering works with the orientation of the actual connector you'll be working with. With that placed in the middle, we have just made the first step towards our wiring diagram. Next, we are going to map out everything that we'll be connecting to the ECU. And that includes the battery, the ignition switch of the car, the injectors, the ignition coils, all the sensors, the engine bay fans, the fuel pump, the main relay, the fuel pump relay, the ignition coil relay, and the fan relay. The purpose of the relays is to protect your ECU and your entire electronic system by making it possible to control high amperage devices such as fans and fuel pumps and the like with a low amperage current. In more simple terms, you're using a weak current to control a strong current. If you were to try and control these devices directly with the ECU, chances are high you would melt or burn wires and the tiny connections inside an ECU which are not designed to handle strong currents. An important note here is that all the cables coming from the positive side of the battery should have fuses on them. You can usually buy a small fuse box and install it to your preferred location and bring all the cables to and from this location to create a tidy install. If you go down to the description, you will see that I made this wiring diagram available in two file formats. The first is a regular JPEG, and the second is a file format suitable for image editing software. So for example, you can download paint.net, which is a free image editing software, and then open the file, this wiring diagram, in that software. And you will see that each of these different wiring segments are separate layers. What this means is that this is not only easy to edit, but you can actually toggle the visibility of each different component as well as set of wires in this wiring diagram. And this then makes it easy for you to focus on a particular point so you don't have to visually navigate the whole forest of lines. Instead, you can just make visible that which you want to analyze at a particular moment, making this a pretty, you know, convenient thing to use to wire up a standalone ECU. The wire coming from the battery to the ignition switch already exists on every car. You won't be bringing in a new wire from the battery to the switch. Instead, you will just hook up to an existing wire coming out of your ignition switch. This wire must have no power when the ignition switch is off, and it must have power when the ignition switch is on and when you're cranking. Whenever you see a point like this on the diagram, it means that the wires are joined together. For example, all the sensor grounds, except for the cram and crank sensors, they join together into a single wire and then hook up into the sensor ground pin on the ECU. When it comes to joining wires together or splicing, there's multiple techniques you can use. I prefer to use a large all-metal butt connectors, which I then later also insulate either using heat shrink or proper tape. Soldering is also okay, but it's very hard to solder many wires together properly, and solder can also crack after long-term exposure to vibrations, which are definitely present in a car. Something else that needs to be said is that this is not set in stone, this wiring diagram, and that a good standalone ECU usually offers multiple options when it comes to pin choices. For example, you can see that our fuel pump is hooked up to pin 41, but that's not the only possibility. Pin 21 also, for example, has the same thing. It's a low side switch with the same parameters. A low side switch basically means that the ECU is switching the ground connection to turn something on or off, whereas a high side switch would be switching the positive connection of whatever it's controlling. Another great place to clear your doubts are sample wiring diagrams that you can find at the end of the AEM user manual. They offer many examples of how to wire different things on different platforms so you can double check that what you're doing actually makes sense. Now, when it comes to sensor types, you can use different types of sensors. All the sensors I use are AEM simply because they're nice, cost-effective, and reliable, and they work with the ECU out of the box. They're usually around $30 to $50 per sensor, depending on the sensor, and they also include the connector as well. However, this ECU can also use a number of different sensors, and you would just have to tell it what you're using in the Infinity Tuner software when you get to the point of configuring your ECU. When it comes to telling Hall effect from variable reluctance, cam and crank sensors, you can usually do this by the number of wires. Hall effect are 3 wires, whereas VR are 2 wires. However, there are exceptions to this, so double check if you're using an OEM sensor. On the other hand, almost all aftermarket cam and crank sensors are Hall effect. With the diagram completed, it's time to turn it into reality. When it comes to wiring in a standalone ECU, you have 3 options. A plug-and-play wiring harness, a flying lead harness, or building a wiring harness from scratch. The plug-and-play will be the most expensive approach with the benefit of minimizing the chances of installation error, making it by far the easiest and the least time-consuming solution. but a plug-and-play product must first exist for your engine slash car slash ECU combo. In many cases, such a product may not be available, so you are left with choosing either between a flying lead and a built-from-scratch harness. These two approaches are relatively similar, and the main difference is that a flying lead ECU harness will contain the wires already pinned into your ECU plug. Your task will be to cut these wires to length and install sensor connectors on them. When building from scratch, which is what I'll be doing in this video, you will be pinning the wires into the connector yourself, which does increase the chances of error, but it reduces cost and allows you to pick the wire colors yourself. After doing this process, my recommendation is that a flying lead harness is the more sensible approach for most, and I will explain the reasoning behind that in the video. Now, regardless of whether you're using a flying lead harness or building the harness from scratch, you will need some specialized tools. A really helpful tool is a set of wire stripping pliers. They enable you to quickly, neatly, and consistently strip wires, and this can really save time and effort because you'll be stripping a minimum of 100 wires on any standalone install. The next thing you need are crimping pliers suitable for crimping small pins that go onto thin gauge wires. You cannot crimp ECU pins with something like this. Now, the numbers on the pliers correspond to different wire gauges, but this isn't set in stone and may vary depending on wire insulation thickness and quality. Once you crimp a few pins, you will see that the quality of your crimping improves quickly. These are $20 pliers I got from Banggood, and honestly, they work just fine for me. If you want something a bit better, you can use these ones from Molex. The other thing you obviously need is wiring in multiple different colors. This amount that you can see here is definitely not enough. I used this much many times over. You will need a lot of wire. When it comes to the thickness of the wire, 18 to 22 gauge is typically what's used and recommended for ECUs. Once you're ready to start wiring, it's a good idea to lay and organize everything on a nice flat surface. It's also really helpful to print out the wiring diagram on a large format paper because you will be looking at this a lot. Now, what you'll essentially be doing during the wiring process is connecting the ECU connector to sensor, injector, coil, and other connectors. Basically, you're joining connectors to other connectors. When it comes to connectors, you should always first figure out what kind of a connector you're working with before stripping and crimping anything. Some connectors are known as pull-to-seat. This means that you first pass the corresponding wire through the connector and only strip and crimp after this. The final step is then pulling the wire back until the pin is seated into its slot. Other connectors may be an opposite process, so you will first strip and crimp the wire and then push it into the connector until it's seated. So definitely check before crimping anything. When it comes to the direction of wiring, you have two choices. You can start at the engine end or at the ECU end. I decided to start at the engine end. This means that you basically wire up all the sensor connectors and then organize and group all the wires and finally find a suitable place through which you enter the cabin and then connect everything into the ECU connector. I also decided to install my expandable braided wire sleeves at this point, although this is not recommended, until you're sure that everything is connected properly and works as it should. I decided to ignore this because the wire sleeving can easily be opened up later for repairs and changes, and because I wanted to avoid the extra work of disconnecting everything and then sleeving and then reconnecting. I chose the cabin for the location of the ECU as it's recommended to keep the ECU away from the temperature fluctuations and vibrations present inside the engine bay. Having the ECU in the cabin is also the most convenient location because you'll be often hooking up with a USB cable to the ECU for tuning purposes. I bought a suitable sized aluminum plate, which I drilled and tapped and then painted black. I then simply bolted the ECU together with the relays and the fuse box to the plate. Once that is done and the wires from your sensors are in the cabin, you can start populating your ECU connector. This is a critical part of the job, and it's important to be focused on the task at hand to avoid mixing up pins. This is the only issue I had with the entire wiring job, and this is why I recommend a flying lead harness instead. Now the Infinity uses a Molex MX123 connector, which I believe is a high quality automotive connector. It's also used by some GM vehicles, I believe. Now Molex offers some very comprehensive install instructions, but this connector really isn't that beginner friendly and simply isn't very easy to work with. One of the reasons is the variation in insulation thickness for the same wire gauges across the world. The other reason is that getting the pin into its seat is sometimes very hard because you really have no leverage over the pin, and this often means that you have to resort to using some sort of needle or very thin screwdriver and a bit of force, and this then risks damaging the connector and causing a short circuit between pins. A useful tip for minimizing potential for damage when populating this and all similar connectors is to populate in order. Don't populate randomly, as this may lead to a situation where you're supposed to install a pin into a location that is now surrounded by other already populated slots, and this will make your work a lot harder. Once the connector is populated, your job is complete. As you can see, my work ended up being a bit messy, largely due to the fact that I ended up splicing thinner gauge wires onto thicker ones to avoid torturing myself with the connector. Fortunately, this mess can easily be organized and sorted, and it will look much better once everything is taped up and tidied up. The final step involves assigning the correct pins to the correct outputs in the tuner software. This is a matter of a few clicks and takes about 3 minutes with the Infinity. When that is done, you can configure the rest of the parameters and start your engine. And this is exactly what we'll be covering in the next video of this series. And that is what needs to be set up correctly in a tuning software and how to do it in order to be able to start the engine for the first time. As always, thanks a lot for watching. I'll be seeing you soon with more fun and useful stuff on the D4A channel.